believe in Christ the Son. I believe in the Holy Spirit. Our God is three and one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again. For I believe in the name of Jesus. I believe in God our Father. I believe in Christ the Son. I believe in the Holy Spirit. Our God is three and one. I believe in the resurrection.
Open wide here.
Savior of the world.
Lord, oh my soul, oh. Praise God. Can we just take a moment and bless the Lord this morning? Is there something in your heart today that you say, God, I just want to give God praise today. I'm thankful that He has done this. I'm thankful for who He is. I just want you to shout it out. Just tell God right now, what is it? Just say it out loud. Just thank Him. Lord, I praise You for the church. Come on, say it out loud. I want to hear it. God, I praise You for family. Come on, church. For health, for faithfulness. Yes, hallelujah. Come on, bless His name today. Praise God. Yes. Thankful for grace. Hallelujah. Anybody else want to bless the Lord this morning? Father, as we've taken these few moments this morning, Lord God, that if our attention wasn't on You, God, I pray that it is now. God, we took the time, Lord, to realize, God, that You have blessed us with so much. God, there's so much to be grateful for, so much to be thankful for, so much to praise Your name for today, God. God, and for that we are so very grateful. We thank You that You truly are a good, good Father. That You are a great Father. That You're even a Father to the fatherless. Maybe there's people here today, God, that experienced not growing up with the Father. But Lord, You stepped in. You stepped in and You said, I will be Him. God, I am very grateful today for my earthly father, and I'm also thankful for my heavenly Father that has taught me so much about what it means to be a daddy. God, I couldn't do it, Lord, if I didn't know You. I would be a failure, Lord God. It's all because of Your grace and Your teaching. Church, we serve a good, good Father. He is there. He is a present help in times of trouble. He is a Father that you can cry out to day, night, morning, evening. It doesn't matter when it is. It can be at 3 o'clock in the morning, and He wants to hear from you. He's always there for you when you need a listening ear. And He's always there to give you correction when you need it. Father, we thank You that You are all these things and more. That we have the privilege of having a Father that cares more about us than we can even fathom. So today, church, as we make this house a house of prayer, let's make this house a house of rejoicing. A house of rejoicing in the Father that we get to love on and that loves us so much that He sent His one and only begotten Son. So that He could call us His children. So whatever you need today, just know you have a good Father. But let's not just make it about needs today, but let's also take time to rejoice with one another. If you have a praise, I want you to come up and I want to praise God with you. I want to pray with you and I want to rejoice with you that God is moving in your life. So let's take this time to make this a house of prayer. If you want to continue worship, worship. If you want to come and fill these altars and just seek the Father, then come and seek Him. If you want us to pray for you, you want us to lift up your need to the Father, we want to do that. But let's take these next few moments. Let's make this house a house of prayer. Talking to the Father of all fathers.
Thank you.
We just want to say thank you, God, today for how good you are. We thank you, Lord, that you, God, are the perfect Father. Lord, when our earthly Father, God, lets us down, God, we thank you that you have never let us down. God, you've always been a constant. For your faithfulness, God, endures forever. We thank you, Lord, for being such a wonderful Father. God, we thank you, Lord God, because you are a good Father. You provide for us. God, you take care of us. You make sure that we have clothes on our back, food on our table. That's how good you are, Lord. And Father, I thank you, God, that you taught us to sow seed. God, you're such a good, good Father. You don't just give us things, but God, you teach us things. You teach us, Lord, to give, to sow. So that you can bring increase in our lives. You teach us to water. You teach us to do all these things, Lord. And God, today I thank you, Lord, that during this time in the service, God, we get to continue to worship you and do what you've taught us to do, and that is to give. Thank you, Lord God, for the gift of giving. You are so good, Lord, for teaching us so well what we are to do so that you can bring increase in our lives. God, bless this offering, Father. Allow it to accomplish that which it was sent for to do. Lord, I pray, God, that all the resources, God, that you give to us, God, that we will manage them and with wisdom and with integrity. And God, we will do with it what you want us to do with it. We give you the praise and glory in Jesus' name. Amen. Praise the Lord. Are you thankful for our worship team? Amen, I am. I'm thankful that they are led by the Spirit of God and anointed to lead us in worship Sunday after Sunday. So very grateful. I always miss y'all. It doesn't feel the same when I'm not up here getting to speak with you than when I'm just sitting over there listening. So I always miss you guys when I'm not doing that. I hope that you enjoyed last week and the missionary that was here. And thank you for giving into missions and doing all of that. Really, really appreciate it. This is the last Sunday for the creed, I believe. Last Sunday, we have gone through this whole creed of what we believe and what we believe. And here's the thing about believing, okay? And here, I'm going to tie this all in with Father's Day and all that, but I want you to understand, when you say you believe something, it causes you to live in a different manner, doesn't it? And so, since we've gone through this, I believe in God the Father, the maker of heaven and earth, and Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, and was crucified, dead and buried, ascended, what does that say? He rose again from the dead, ascended into heaven, and sits on the right hand of God the Father Almighty, and thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, and the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. See, when I say I believe these things, it's going to cause me to live in a different way, is it not? If it doesn't, then you don't really believe. Because even the Bible says this about the demons. It says they believe in God, and they tremble. Right? They tremble. It causes something in there. Oh, man, I believe in God because I know where I'm going when this is all over, right? They believe that God is real and that God is going to do with them what he said he was going to do with them, right? So when we look at this, the resurrection of the body and life everlasting, when you say that you believe in the resurrection of the body and life everlasting, how would that change you on the inside? How would that cause you to believe, to live differently? Well, I would say this. It should change every avenue, every area of your life. It should change you at your workplace. It should change it the way you parent. It should change the way you're a spouse. It should change the way you are a believer. It should change every aspect of your life, right? Because you know there's going to be a resurrection of the body. I don't know about you, but I want all my kids going to be a part of that. Amen. I want my spouse to be a part of that. I want every believer in the church to be a part of that. I want every person in my workplace to be a part of that. But I have to truly believe it has to be deep down inside, right? Because if I just surface, yeah, I believe that, you know, there's going to be a resurrection of the body one day, you know, just through confession, just with your lips, yeah, I believe that. It's not going to change you. It's not going to cause you to share life with that person that doesn't have life, right? So we have to be willing to step up and step out if we believe these things. Are you willing? If you really believe this, it's going to cause, hey, there's going to be a resurrection of the body one day, and Jesus is going to reign in heaven forever, and only the people that know him are going to go there. I just noticed you don't know Jesus. Should that do something inside of me? What does it do to you to know there's lost souls all around you every day? Have you just kind of grown cold, kind of grown calloused to knowing that there's lost people all around you? Now, I know, I get it. We can't save them, okay? I can't save them, but I can plant and water, right? I can do my part in order for God to do his part, right? But if I don't plant a seed and I don't water a seed, how's God going to bring the increase? It'd be like me going out to the garden again. You know, a thing full of dirt. I'm not going to plant any seed, but I'm going to expect something in the future. That would be idiotic, right? Let's just be straightforward here. That would be not right. That would be dumb on my part. I didn't plant any seed here, but I'm expecting in 3 months to come out here and pick some food. How are we ever going to harvest souls if we're never planting and watering in people's lives? Amen? And this should challenge us. If we say we believe in the resurrection of the body and life everlasting, there's people that's not going there. Right? There's people that are not going to experience. If they were to die today, they would not experience life everlasting. I hope that bothers us as believers. It bothers me. I wish I could save the whole world right now. I really do. But it doesn't work that way, does it? If you have your Bibles, turn with me to John chapter 14. John chapter 14. John chapter 14. Jesus, we're going to lay some groundwork to just kind of drive this point home of there is a resurrection of the body. There is life everlasting with Jesus Christ. John chapter 14, starting in verse 1, says, "Don't let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God and trust also in me. There is more than enough room in my Father's home. If this were not so, I would have told you, and I am going to prepare a place for you. When everything is ready, I will come and get you, so that you will always be with me where I am." Did you hear that? When it's ready. Okay, God, Jesus up there, he's like, "Hey, I'll see you later. I'm going to ascend to the Father, and I'm going to begin preparing a place for you. And when it's ready, I'm going to come and get you." Okay? When it's ready, I'm going to come and get you. So when Jesus is completely fulfilled and completely gotten our place ready, he's going to come back and he's going to rescue us from this fallen world. That's good news, right? Anybody ever get tired of this fallen world? Come on. But here's the thing. If you're not tired of this fallen world, then you've gotten too comfortable here. This isn't your home. Amen? This is not your home. You see, this is why we can trust the Lord. As difficult life gets and can get, we know that this is not the end. We have a Savior that's going to come rescue us from this world. Philippians 3 verse 20 says, "But we are citizens of heaven, where the Lord Jesus Christ lives. And we are eagerly awaiting for Him to return as our Savior. He will take our weak mortal bodies and change them into glorious bodies like His own, using the same power with which He will bring everything under His control." How many has ever thought, man, Pastor, I know this isn't my home, but man, I really want to see my grandkids grow up. I really want to see this. I really want to see that. So if Jesus could just hold off until all that happens, do you really think that when you're shooting up into the air that that's going to be on your mind? If it is, then this world, you got too comfortable here, right? You got way too comfortable here if that's what's on your mind when you're shooting up in the air. But Jesus, I didn't get to see my grandkids. Man. I say, come, Lord Jesus, come quickly. Amen. Right now, let's just get it done. Of course, I want other people to be saved, so does God. He wants all men to come to repentance. That's why He hasn't parted the eastern sky yet and come back to get us. But He said, we are citizens in heaven. Did you hear that? I know you've got your citizenship in this country. But again, this isn't your home. That's not the same. That holds a higher regard. The citizenship in heaven holds a higher regard than the citizenship here. Right? I got lots of scripture today, but it's good. 1 Peter chapter 1. 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 3. All praise to God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. It is by His great mercy that we have been born again. Because God raised Jesus Christ from the dead, now we live with great expectation. And we have a priceless inheritance, an inheritance that is kept in heaven for you, pure and undefiled, beyond the reach of change and decay. And through your faith, God is protecting you by His power until you receive this salvation, which is ready to be revealed to you, revealed on the last day for all to see. So be truly glad. There is wonderful joy ahead, even though you must endure many trials for a little while. Anybody enduring any trials right now? These trials will show that your faith is genuine. It is being tested as fire tests and purifies gold. Though your faith is far more precious than mere gold, so when your faith remains strong through many trials, it will bring you much praise and glory and honor on the day when Jesus Christ is revealed to the whole world. So, think about this, okay? You believe Jesus is going to be revealed to the whole world, right? So think about what it says before that. Does that make it any easier to endure? Because we believe, right? We believe that. We know that there is joy ahead. We know this isn't the end. We know that there's something more than what this world has to offer us. Now, it says when we are born again, is being born and born again different? If it isn't different to you, then we need to talk, right? Being born is something, you came into this world as a baby, and your mom and dad raised you, right? And in the flesh, you were born in the flesh as this child. But as you got older and somebody told you about Jesus and you said, yes, I need Jesus as my Savior. You were born again through the Spirit. Now you died to the flesh, you crucified the flesh, and you came alive in Jesus Christ to do His will and to do His purposes. You were bought with a price. You were born again, right? Born again for what purpose? But when you were born, you satisfied your own sinful pleasures, right? But when you're born again, now you're here to satisfy the pleasure of Jesus Christ for your life. And the good news is, if you will do that, there is an inheritance for each one that lives in Christ awaiting them. Isn't that good news? There's an inheritance for you. Now I know some people may think, well, Pastor, I'm 15. That's a long ways off. Is it? Is it a long ways off? We don't know that, do we? I bet you there was a 15-year-old that died yesterday. I know that's morbid, but I bet there was. Right? But this is why we have to let go of things here. This is why we can't become too attached. Can anybody say, I become too attached to the world at times? Yeah, right here, I can. Right? I can. We have to let go of stuff. You see, throw up some of the mid-slides for me again. For there, James, if you would, please. There's some mid-slides that are very, very important. The last one or the next to last one that you threw up this morning. Look at this. Your greatest contribution to the kingdom of God may not be something you do, but someone you raise. What do you think about that? Yeah. See, we get so caught up in stuff. We get so caught up in the things of this world when we should be investing something so much greater. You know, I have to tell you this about my dad. My dad was a good dad. He spent time with me. Anytime I went to him and I said, Dad, go hit me balls out in the yard. He was out in the yard. I mean, it was almost automatic. He hardly ever told me no about that. He was a good dad. And yo, those were great things that he did for me. But the greatest thing he ever did for me was he took me to Promise Keepers. He took me to retreats. He invested in me spiritually. Because of that investment, because of that seed that was planted and watered in me, God brought forth increase, and here I am today doing what God called me to do. You see, if my dad would have just been like, well, I'll teach you all these other things, but that wouldn't have been a good investment. You know, I'm thankful that we have sports, and because I like watching sports. I'm thankful for those things, right? But if sports ever takes over the life of my child or my life, then it's wrong, right? I become too attached to the world. I become too comfortable here. You see, my son is on the swim team now. And I want him to swim well. But if it begins to cost him his relationship with Jesus, no more swimming. Because it's not that important to me how well he swims. You know what's important to me? How well he follows Jesus. Now, it may be different for some people, but I'm telling you, there's only one investment that's going to take them into eternity. It's not how well they swing a bat. It's not how high their batting average is. It's not how fast my son swims or how good my daughter sings. Right? It's how they live their life for Jesus. I've got 18 years. I got 18 years to teach them that this world is not their home. That Jesus is way more important than anything they're going to come up to in life. I got 18 years. And I don't want to miss a chance to teach them that. I want to go into this parable with that thought. There was a man, Luke chapter 12, there was a man who had a lot of crops, a good seed. His soil was fertile. And so one day he had so many crops, he thought to himself, man, I've got so many crops. What should I do? I know what I'll do. I'll tear down my barn and I'll build a big old barn so I have enough room for all my crops, right? I'll get attached to this world. I'll enjoy the pleasures of this world. And then he said, once I build all these barns, I have these crops, I got all this food stored up, I'm just going to take it easy. I'm going to kick back, eat and drink and be merry. But God said to him, you fool, you will die this very night. Then who will get everything you work for? Yes, a person is a fool to store up earthly wealth but not have a rich relationship with God. Did you hear that? A person is a fool who will store up earthly wealth but not have a rich relationship with God. I got a Father's Day card this morning. Hopefully all of you guys did. If you didn't, I'm sorry. But I got one this morning. And I spend time with my children as often as I can. When I'm not here, when I'm not doing ministry, when I want to spend time with them. And I know I'm the pastor, okay? But I'm not pulling the pastor card because this is how I would be if I was the pastor or not. Okay, I don't want you guys to think, oh, well, yeah, he's the pastor. That's what he's supposed to do. Right? Okay, who's ever thought that? Well, that's the way the pastor is supposed to raise his children. Really? I'm just trying to be an example to everybody else, right? I'm just trying to do that, and I fail very often. I wish I could say I'm the perfect father, but I'm not. I'm far from it. But I got a card today, and my two oldest kids both said this: thank you for teaching us about Jesus. That's the greatest gift. They didn't have to give me anything. They could have just told me that, and I would have been, hey, that's the best Father's Day gift I've ever had. That my kids are thankful that I taught them about Jesus. What a gift, right? What a gift. So what are you doing? What are you pouring into your children? Because if you believe that Jesus is coming back, you believe there is life everlasting beyond this earth, then we need to be taking the time to invest in the next generation. We need to be investing in the people around us, the things that really, really matter. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 11 says, "Dear friends, I warn you as temporary residents and foreigners to keep away from worldly desires that wage war against your very souls. Be careful to live properly among your unbelieving neighbors. But even if they accuse you of doing wrong, they will see your honorable behavior and they will give honor to God when He judges the world." I warn you as temporary residents and foreigners. Do you see yourself as aliens of this world? Is there times where you've gone through this life where you just don't feel like you fit in? I hope so. If you don't feel like you fit in, that's a good thing, right? Because we need to stand out. And I want you to understand the reward is coming. How many can say that most of my life I've heard that Jesus is coming back? Right? How many can say that? Most of my life I've heard Jesus is coming back. Jesus is coming back. Is He really coming back? Yes, He is. Yes, Jesus is really coming back. And the Bible says this in Galatians 6, "We must not grow weary in well-doing, for we will reap a harvest if we will not faint." Right? We will reap a harvest if we will not faint. We can't grow weary in well-doing. We must do the things that God has called us to do. You see, many people, even in Peter's day, they started saying, "Jesus is going to come back. Jesus hadn't been gone very long at all, right? And people are already thinking, yeah, right, is Jesus really going to come back? And now here we are 2,000 years later, Jesus still hasn't came back. But Peter gives us some reassurance in chapter 3 of 2 Peter. He says, "And scoffers will come and they will say that they have been saying, scoffers will say they have been saying Jesus coming back for years, but nothing has happened." Right? You're going to have scoffers come along and say, "Oh yeah, they've been saying that for years. Nothing's happened. Where's Jesus?" Don't let it derail you. Okay, I'm telling you, this is going to happen and it's going to be good. Because we have a hope. We have a hope. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. This is going to happen one day, and I'm looking forward to it. It's going to be an amazing, amazing moment. Verse 13, it says, "And now, dear brothers and sisters, we want you to know what will happen to the believers who have died, so you will not grieve like people who have no hope." Did you hear that? Not grieve like people who have no hope. You know, when we sit in funerals, when we sit in places where we've lost loved ones, who are we really mourning for? For me. We should be excited, enthused. I mean, we should be so enthralled with where they're at and what they're getting, right? To be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. If they knew Jesus Christ, praise the Lord, praise God. I'm not crying for them, man. They're in a lot better, they're way better off than me, right? Man, how can we switch places? That's more what I'm thinking. I mean, man, they're in a good place, right? No more pain, no more tears, no more suffering. So we don't grieve like people who have no hope. We don't grieve for them, we grieve for ourselves. For since we believe that Jesus died and was raised to life again, we also believe that when Jesus returns, God will bring back with him the believers who have died. We tell you this directly from the Lord. We who are still living when the Lord returns will not meet him ahead of those who have died. For the Lord himself will come down from heaven with a commanding shout, with the voice of the archangel and the trumpet call of God. First, the believers who have died will rise from their graves. And then together with them, we who are still alive and remain on the earth will be caught up in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. Then we'll be with the Lord forever. So encourage each other with these words. Amen? Are you encouraged today? Praise God, we don't have to grieve like people with no hope. See, it's not goodbye, it's see you later. Right? I'm going to see you later. I get to see you again. Why? Because you knew Jesus, I know Jesus, and because we have that in common, we get to spend eternity with together. Praise God. You see, there's going to come a day, whether it's through death or through the rapture of the saints, that this world right here is no longer going to be where we're found. Right? Hebrews 13:14 says, "For this world is not our permanent home. We are looking for a home yet to come." This world is not our permanent home. You know, when you go on vacation, you sleep in a different bed. You know, it doesn't matter how comfortable that bed is. It's not your bed, right? You know, and I don't know about you, but for me, even a different shower is hard, right? It's like, man, this shower is not the same as my shower. You know what I mean? Yeah, this shower doesn't spray the same. It doesn't have the same pressure as mine. You know, it just doesn't feel the same. All my stuff's right there, right, to wash myself. It's all right there. Well, I need my foo-foo, okay? And my soap and my shampoo, right? But, you know, there's no shower like my shower. There's no bed like my bed. You know, there's no place like home. Would you agree with that? You know, even though as great as vacation was, when you get home, you're just like, oh, man, there's no place. You just, it's a place where you know you can be you, right? And so that's exactly what God is saying. He's like, you can't even really be the true you yet, right? You can't even be the true you yet because you haven't even arrived at home. You're just kind of on vacation. Okay, you're on vacation in this world. Sometimes this vacation doesn't seem very pleasant. So most time, none of us would have booked this vacation, right? It's like, wait, I didn't book that. No, God, that's not what I wanted to do on this vacation. And, of course, not to mention, you have to live out of your suitcase. Who likes doing that? I don't, just because of the simple fact that my wife yells at me that I don't put it back the way that I found it. You know what I mean? So I'm looking forward to being at home, right? To being at home to where I can, of course, she yells at me when I don't put my drawers back the way well, she gets on to me or whatever. Yeah, for not putting my drawers back. But anyway, okay. My wife doesn't yell. But What I'm saying is there's no place like home, right? But, you know, this isn't my home. And, you know, I need to get that in my spirit that there is no place like home. And I know, you know, you say, but it's a place that I don't even know what it's like. It's like, yeah, but you can get an idea, right? You can get an idea. And I don't know about you, but I long for that place where there's no more pain, no more suffering, where there's streets of gold, where there's a crystal sea, where the throne of God, where I can see Jesus face to face, where Jesus is illuminating the whole place just because of the brightness of his life, right? I look forward to that. And Paul even said in Romans chapter 8 that this is something. Did you know that this is something that people actually have, it's scientifically proven that eternity is something that people are actually desiring. There's something inside of every single person. There's this desire for eternity. Whatever that is, whatever that looks like to them, some people haven't come to the right conclusion of what eternity looks like. But it even says this in Romans chapter 8, verse 19. It says, "For all creation is waiting eagerly for that future day when God will reveal who His children really are." Right? All creation is waiting eagerly. Against its will, all creation was subjected to God's curse. Okay, you heard that, right? Against our will, we were subjected to God's curse. But with eager hope, the creation looks forward to the day when it will join God's children in glorious freedom from death and decay. You know, in heaven, nothing's going to decay. There's not going to be any more death. There's not going to be any mourning. There's not going to be any sorrow. No, there's going to be joy unspeakable and full of glory. And that's how we're going to walk around all the time. That's good news, right? So there's a yearning inside of all of us for heaven. And so we should not allow ourselves to grow comfortable here. 1 John chapter 2, verse 15 says, "Do not love this world, nor the things it offers you. For when you love the world, you do not have the love of the Father in you. For the world offers only a craving for physical pleasure, a craving for everything we see, and pride in our achievements and possessions. These are not from the Father, but are from this world. And this world is fading away along with everything that people crave. But anyone who does what pleases God will live forever." You know, I'm sure that I've seen pictures of people where people have gone for vacation, and God did an awesome job creating this world, did He not? I mean, an amazing job. I mean, we cannot deny that. God has done an amazing job creating this world. But God did an even better job creating our home in heaven. Amen? That's where it's at right there. God did an amazing job creating our home in heaven. And as much as we, you know, yeah, we're temporary, we're passing through, but we cannot allow the things of this world to cloud us from where we are actually from. Same chapter of Romans chapter 8, verse 23, it says, "And we believers also groan, even though we have the Holy Spirit within us as a foretaste of future glory. We long for our bodies to be released from sin and suffering. We too wait with eager hope for the day when God will give us our full rights as His adopted children, including the new bodies He has promised us. We were given this hope when we were saved. If we already have something, we don't need to hope for it. But if we look forward to something we don't yet have, we must wait patiently and confidently." Does anybody ever get impatient? Does anybody ever even get impatient? You know, it's like there's some days where it's like, "Lord, you can come and take me now." I mean, I'm not going to lie to you. There's times where it's like, "Man, really, Lord, I'd much rather be with you at this point in time." But I know that's got to be done on His terms, not mine, right? So the question is this today. Are you convinced that this is not our home? Are you convinced that this is not our home? Are you convinced Or I'm sorry, have you grown too comfortable here? Is this a place that you've grown too comfortable in? Is this a place where you just kind of kicked back and thought, oh, I can just do whatever I want, whenever I want, however I want, and I don't have to answer to anybody? And if that's the attitude, then I'm not even going to ask when the last time you witnessed to somebody and they accepted Jesus, because it probably hasn't happened. Okay? Because when we have that attitude, we're too self-centered to talk to anybody else about Jesus, right? It's not about me. If I've grown so comfortable here, if I have forgotten that this is not my home, then I'm not going to be telling anybody else about Jesus, because I think that I'm going to be here forever. You know, I think about my neighbor that lives right down the street from us. He's had the privilege of living on this earth for 105 years. But you know what? There's still going to be people that cry when he leaves, when he's no longer here. They had 105 years with him. And you know, a lot of times, you know why people cry? Because they forgot that this isn't their home. You know why people, I mean, it's not wrong to cry and to mourn, but I'm saying the reason why people are super depressed when people leave is because they forget that this isn't their home. They forget that people have to leave here because this isn't eternity. This isn't eternal. This is temporary, right? Everything you see around you is temporary. It's all gonna burn up at the brightness of Jesus coming, except for the people that are here. Right? This chair, this building, everything, it's just gonna be gone. But the people around you are gonna go somewhere. They're gonna go somewhere. Whether it be your kids, whether it be your friends, whether it be your spouse, they're all gonna go somewhere, right? And I'm telling you, if you truly believe that Jesus is coming back, we have to be the ones to warn them that they're going somewhere. And there's only one place that's going to get them where they want to be. There's only one person, that's Jesus Christ. There's only one investment that can be made, and that's Jesus Christ. Romans 8:18, Paul declares this, "Yet what we suffer now is nothing compared to the glory he will reveal to us later." Did you hear that? What we are suffering now is nothing compared to the glory he's going to reveal to us in our home with him. There will come a day when all this will be no more. So where are you at, church? Do you believe this is your home, or do you believe you have a home waiting for you? Have you grown too comfortable in your own skin? I want to finish with this scripture right here. It says in 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 20, "So we are Christ's ambassadors. God is making his appeal through us. We speak for Christ when we plead, 'Come back to God.' For God made Christ who never sinned to be the offering for our sin so that we can be made right with God through Christ." Do you know what an ambassador is? It's a diplomat sent from another country to be a spokesperson in a foreign country. Do you know what an ambassador is? It's a diplomat from another country to be a spokesperson in a foreign country for that country. If you don't get it yet, that means that we were sent here from heaven to this foreign country we call Earth to share the message that we got from home with the world around us. See, the Bible just called you that. If you're His, you don't have a choice. You are Christ's ambassadors. You are His messenger to this foreign country about heaven and Jesus Christ. That's who you are. That's who you are. This is not our home. And us believing this is our home is affecting the way we share Christ. It's affecting the way we raise our children. It's affecting the way we treat our spouse. It's affecting the way we treat our friends. It's affecting our lives. Is it not? Stand with me this morning. Maybe you're here today and you said, Pastor, I've gotten too comfortable in my own skin. I haven't been making the investments where I need to make them, but I've been making my investments out of my own selfish ambition, my own selfish desires, my own pleasure for this world. Church, I just want us to get this because this is vitally important. If we say we believe, then our lives need to show our belief. So if you're here today, and you're saying, you know what, I become too comfortable here. I needed to hear the message that this is not my home. Yes, I love my family. I love being with them. But church, I want you to understand, if you love them so much, make the right investment in them. Put the right things in their hearts and in their lives. So if you're here today and you're saying, Pastor, I want to make a declaration in my own heart today, and I want to come back home. I want to declare that this is not where I belong. This is your opportunity right now, church, as the worship team sings this. Let's lift our voices. Let this be heartfelt. And let it be true inside of you. Go ahead.
Sometimes it feels like I'm bleeding. But am I alive? I won't keep searching for answers that aren't here to find.
All I know is I'm not home yet. This is not where I belong. Did this world begin? Jesus, this is not where I belong.
So when the walls keep falling down on me, and when I'm lost in the current of a raging sea, I have this blessed assurance holding me.
Where I belong.
Praise the Lord. This isn't where you belong, is it, church? You're on a journey, and that journey is towards heaven. Don't forget it. And there's no such thing as being too heavenly minded that you're no earthly good. Okay, that's a lie that somebody made up that phrase. That's a lie. Because if you're heavenly minded, you know there's a place that you're going. And you know you want other people to go with you. Amen. So if you're thinking of heaven, praise God. Father, I just thank you so much, Lord. God, this is not the end of life for us. God, we have hope today. We have a hope in Jesus Christ, the Savior that died for the entire world. And as we have accepted Him as our Savior and Lord, God, we have that hope inside of us that this is not our home. This is not where we belong. God, we are passing through. We are temporary residents. We are foreigners. We are aliens through this land, Father. You did not call us to stay here, but you called us to pass through. So, Lord, right now, God, I pray, Father God, that, Lord, as we leave this place, God, that it will be in the depths of our heart, God, that we believe that Jesus is coming back. Jesus is coming back. Jesus is coming back. Hallelujah. And, Lord, I pray that we will be ready. And I pray that we won't just be ready, but the people around us will be ready as well. Because we chose to tell them about Jesus. God, I love you. I praise you. I honor you, Lord. Make us a church that wins souls. Make us a church that wins souls for the kingdom of God. In Jesus' name, help us to invest in our families, our friends, and our loved ones by sharing Jesus with them. We give you all the praise and all the glory in Jesus' name. And the church said, amen. Go forth and be blessed. Happy Father's Day. Love y'all.